Welcome to the Apheresis Pro blog. Over the last 3 months, I have been inundated with questions about apheresis and COVID-19. Today, I'm going to address these questions and tell you about all the information we have so far. Please remember, we've been in this for less than 4 months. We're still learning. There are different opinions of how to handle the COVID-19 epidemic. However, everybody agrees on one thing. We urgently need a vaccine. There are a couple of problems with vaccines, and one of them is that it takes a long time to develop, test, and get approved by the FDA. The other problem is that it sometimes doesn't work. Bill Gates should know this firsthand, since he funded most of the malaria vaccine project. Even more money and scientific efforts have been spent for the development of a vaccine against the HIV over the last 30 years, and we still don't have one. But don't get me wrong, vaccines have saved humanity from many terrible diseases, and I hope that a vaccine for this coronavirus will be available soon. But what do we do in the meantime? While conventional vaccines provide active immunity, convalescent plasma provides passive immunity. People who have been infected with the novel coronavirus and have completely recovered have circulating IgG antibodies in their plasma against the virus. This so-called convalescent plasma is collected with plasmapheresis and can be used for the prevention of the disease or for the treatment of COVID-19. There are reports from China and more recently from the US that show promising results when convalescent plasma infusions are used early in the disease. Eventually, convalescent plasma can be used to make intravenous immunoglobulins specific for the coronavirus. A novel approach for procuring virus-specific IgG antibodies is to pass the plasma through an IgG immunoadsorption column and then elute the column to collect the IgG. More recently, a company in the US announced a monoclonal antibody against the novel coronavirus. This can be very promising and can be developed much faster than a vaccine. Now, let's move on to therapeutic plasma exchange. By now, we know that the majority of the patients who have the severe form of COVID-19 are elderly individuals and people with underlying conditions. So why is that? It is widely believed that the underlying cause of the aging process is chronic inflammation, hence the term inflammaging. Systemic chronic inflammation is also the underlying pathophysiology of the pre-existing conditions associated with COVID-19. Let us take a brief look at the inflammation process. During a viral or bacterial infection, the immune system responds with acute inflammation. This is characterized by a complex interaction of many immunocompetent cells and their products. A large amount of pro-inflammatory substances, such as cytokines and chemokines, are released in the circulation. Once the infectious agent is killed, the regulatory portion of the immune system returns it to a dormant state. If a long-standing, low-grade infection persists, or a regulatory portion of the immune system malfunctions, chronic inflammation takes place. Chronic inflammation is not as robust as acute inflammation, but it is continuous and relentless. There is a constant release of pro-inflammatory factors, and over time, they attack and cause tissue damage to various organs similar to autoimmune diseases. If a person with chronic inflammation is infected with the novel coronavirus, it triggers an acute inflammatory response. This is associated with the release of new pro-inflammatory factors joining the already existing ones from the chronic inflammatory process. This overwhelming inflammatory response is called the cytokine storm. This uncontrolled excessive immune response very rapidly results in organ damage. Although the lungs are the primary target for this immune response, no organ is spared. The kidneys are affected in 30 to 60% of hospitalized patients. The question I get all the time is whether therapeutic plasma exchange may be helpful in removing pro-inflammatory factors during a cytokine storm. Cytokine storm is not unique to COVID-19. Previous experience with this phenomenon in sepsis and after infusion of CAR T cells has demonstrated that TPE is helpful in the management of these patients. Currently, there are several clinical trials in the US and in Europe testing a number of devices capable of removing cytokines in COVID-19 patients. There are a couple of hemoperfusion devices. Cytosorb is one of them. The other one is called C-Clear. They both work in conjunction with CRRT, continuous renal replacement therapy. A complicated factor using these devices is a possible obstruction of the filter. Many of the COVID-19 patients have coagulopathies leading to the formation of small thrombi in the circulation. These circulating thrombi can cause obstruction of the filter and subsequent failure. On the apheresis side, Terumo BCT has partnered with a German company, Marker Technologies, and offers a system combining plasma separation with the SpectroOptia and attached plasma filter, which specifically removes cytokines from plasma. And of course, there is the standard therapeutic plasma exchange. TPE has been used successfully in the treatment and prevention of cytokine storm in other medical conditions. TPE is also an approved immunomodulatory therapy for a number of autoimmune diseases, including Guillain-Barré syndrome and the catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome, both of which can be an early manifestation of the disease or a sequela of the viral infection. There is limited experience with all these modalities at the present time, but multiple clinical trials are ongoing at this time. I just learned that a good friend of mine and a prominent nephrologist, Dr. Vladimir Spirt, is conducting a trial of therapeutic plasma exchange with convalescent plasma in Denmark. I can't wait to see the results of this study. Whatever treatment you choose for your patient, you should start as early as possible. Once the patient has been intubated, a tissue damage to the lungs and quite possibly other organs has already occurred. Many of these patients will die, and if they do survive, they will have permanent organ damage. Patients with severe COVID-19 are usually admitted to the hospital within this time frame. You have 24 to maximum 36 hours to initiate treatment. Remember Tamiflu? It's very effective against the seasonal flu. However, it only works if taken during the first 2 days of the infection. These are the parameters we use to initiate treatment as soon as possible. Respiratory distress, elevated white blood cell count, low lymphocyte count, high levels of C-reactive protein, high levels of ferritin, and high levels of LDH. LDH is a prognostic indicator of poor outcome. It is a biomarker of tissue damage. The presence of these parameters indicates severe inflammation and impending cytokine storm. Whatever treatment you choose for your patient, you should start as early as possible. This is my email. If you have any further questions, please don't hesitate to contact me. In the meantime, stay safe and healthy. Your loved ones and your patients need you. Until next time, I'm Dr. Dobry Kiprov.